Today's webinar will take a look at strategies for driving for taking a data-driven approach to marketing. I'm excited to introduce our two presenters, Amy Reams and Kathy Young. Amy is head of partnerships at Gigya, where she helps leading brands tie social and behavioral data into marketing platforms to improve campaign performance and conversion. And Kathy is VP of client optimization and analytics at Sell-Through, where she works with top brands in commerce and media, helping them increase customer retention and improve top-line revenue. So just a few logistics to cover before we get started. Amy and Kathy will talk for about 40 minutes, and then we'll have some time at the end for audience questions. At any time, please send your questions through the chat window and GoToWebinar, and we'll address them at the end of the session. Finally, this webinar will be recorded, and we'll follow up with a link to the recording via email. And with that, I'd like to hand it over to Amy to get into it.
Great. Thank you, Kevin. I'm excited to be here. Thanks to Kathy for joining us. As Kevin mentioned, I'm Amy Reams. I manage Gigya's business development team. So I oversee all strategic, technical, and business alliances, including our partnership with Sell-Through. So to kick us off, I'd like to discuss this concept of today's hyper-connected consumer. So as many of you on the phone well know, consumers are more connected today than ever before. People are connecting with brands across all sorts of devices, from phones to tablets, cars, wristbands, even glasses or toothbrushes today. And with such connectivity, brands have an enormous opportunity to connect with consumers at all touch points. And when this is done right, this can lead to a deeper development of business-consumer relationships that can last a lifetime. Of course, with anything that's exciting, there always poses challenges as well. So such connectivity provides businesses and marketers with a few major obstacles that they need to overcome. So we're finding that businesses are needing to overcome one or more of the three following challenges. The first is providing a consistent user experience. So with so many different points of access to the web, businesses now find themselves having to provide a consistent experience across various screen sizes and various development environments. Think about the need to adapt for Android, for iOS, for Windows, and more. Another challenge beyond that is consolidating information from multiple touch points. So though these new points of connectivity represent a new data point for businesses to collect and make sense of, it also means that consolidating these data points into a singular view for marketers to access and apply is by no means an easy task. The third challenge is keeping pace with consumer data in the age of social media. So we've talked a lot about how this user is hyper-connected, and social media is a big piece of that. And really with that, it presents yet another challenge because on one hand, it provides businesses with an incredible amount of understanding of consumer preferences and behaviors, but it is also a hurdle for businesses to keep pace with the rich information that is ever-changing and ever-growing from the social providers. With these challenges in mind, though, it is important to pay close attention to them because when businesses are able to adapt and are able to take on such challenges, they really are reaping real benefits, and real benefits that can affect a company's bottom line. So this slide you're looking at points out three major stats that illustrate the value of adapting your business to have connected consumer management. So the first is that when incorporating a multi-channel strategy, 40% of marketers have seen a 15% or more increase in revenues. Additionally, by centralizing and operationalizing consumer intelligence, retention rates rise 3.5 times. And last but not least, creating a social and personalized site experience will yield a 19% increase in sales. So these results have really been made possible, as I mentioned, with the advent of social media, mobile, and connected devices. For a marketer, it's now finally possible to fully understand your customers across their interests, their proximity, education, relationships, work history, and more. We at Gigya really call this the consumer identity. So in order to see the results shown on the previous slide, businesses must shift their focus to accessing this consumer identity, as it's critical to achieving personalized one-to-one consumer communication. However, in return for such information, consumers are now expecting a more relevant user experience across all points of communication. So when a business is shifting their focus to accessing the consumer identity, businesses must also be sure to take close consideration to both privacy and transparency with their end users. So this is where this notion of the logged-in user revolution becomes paramount to marketers. So I'm sure some of you have read some of these articles on Digiday or on TechCrunch, but the real gist of the logged-in user revolution is that government organizations like the FTC and consumer expectations at large are now forcing businesses to rely less on traditional cookies and more on privacy-friendly methods of identifying customers through things like registration and login. Of course, as mobile also becomes more important, we're finding that cookies don't translate well to mobile. So now that there's this big shift of consumer time spent on mobile devices, the logged-in user is quickly becoming incredibly valued to all marketers, both in the mobile form as well as traditional marketing as well. Therefore, we find the best approach to acquire new users along with consumer identity data is through social login. So quick insight for those of you that are not familiar with social login, it's really the ability to register or log in to a site or application using your identity from an existing social provider such as Facebook, Google, Amazon, or Yahoo. And social login is absolutely becoming the preferred method of registration, and the reason that's so is really for the following reasons. First, it's streamlined, right? It's quick and easy for users to simply click the social login icon instead of filling out a full registration form. It also reduces forgotten password frustration. We're all used to having to click that forgotten password button there, but with social login, it removes the need to create this new password on every site or every application that I want to participate with. Social login also increases registration. So we're seeing on average about a 33% increase in registrations for marketers that make social login an option within their experiences. Most of all, it gives permission-based access to rich consumer identity data, which I'll talk about in the next few slides. So if you're one of more than 50% of internet users who's logged in with a social network, I'm sure you're pretty familiar with the screen here. This is the authentication window that is served up from Facebook login. So this dialog is critical really for two major reasons. The first is transparency. So this screen here lets the user know what information about them is being passed to Forbes in this instance. The second is the notion of permission. So by clicking OK here, the user is giving explicit consent for a business to access information about them. So, of course, these elements not only help establish trust, which is critical for personalized marketing, but it also increases the accuracy of the data as well. Again, this is explicit information. It's not just implied insight that a business could learn through cookies or third-party data tools. So now that we can all hopefully agree that identity is a critical component to the future of marketing, I'd like to provide some best practices for gaining access to consumer identity, starting with giving users a reason to sign in or register on your digital properties. So for all those marketers out there, I hope these next few best practices are really something that you can use and can apply in your everyday implementations. So in this example, you're looking at Kate Spade's site, Saturday.com. They're illustrating that by signing up on their site, the user will unlock access to new arrivals and receive a free gift on top of that. Certainly not a bad incentive to register, especially if you're a Kate Spade shopper here. So we find that by providing some context around why a user should share their identity and establishing this mutual value proposition or call to action, it leads to a higher conversion rate and customer satisfaction. A few additional reasons that I personally have encountered to register on a site include something like sign in socially to see what my friends are doing on the site, or sign in to access gated content, view videos, read articles, or unique features. Even something, honestly, as simple as using social login because it's faster and you don't have to remember a new username or password is a good call to action for businesses today. Moving into another best practice here, we find that another best practice for implementing social login is to support login and registration from multiple providers. We recommend that at a bare minimum, a business offers at least three different methods for logging in with a social identity. The reason is that consumers prefer using a variety of social networks. And as I'm sure you guys are thinking, yes, Facebook is the most popular, but we are actually finding that it only makes up about half of all social registration. This diagram here showcases that other networks such as Google+, Yahoo, Twitter, or even LinkedIn are becoming frequently used across the web. So as a business, by providing users with choice, you'll be able to get the most out of social customer acquisition. A third best practice is asking for the right data at the right time. So what you're looking at here is The Independent, and they're improving the reader experience by allowing users to see what content friends on social networks are engaging with on The Independent. So that bottom area down that's highlighted in yellow is prompting the users to start that social reading experience. And when the user clicks to do so, The Independent calls the Facebook permission needed to provide this specific user experience on the site. So in this case, permissions match with what the user wants to do. And what they're asking for is access to the reader's friends list and public profile. Another example of this is posting to a user's wall. So certainly important for a brand in terms of SEO and organic content, but what we find is the ideal place to ask for this permission is not necessarily at the initial point of registration, but it's really at the point where users have that opportunity to share or they're viewing share-worthy content on the site. So now that you have a good idea of how to access this first-party consumer data in a responsible way, I want to transition into how you can collect and manage that data so that it can be applied to improve customer relationships and marketing performance. So first and foremost, what is the data that I've been referencing? Right, let's take a look at what this data is that's captured through social login. So this slide here is still showing Forbes.com, one of Gigya's clients. And at the bottom right, you're seeing the matrix of the various data points that can be collected from the individual social networks. So, of course, if you think about traditional registration, it's normally about 2 to 7 form fields, things like name or email, occasionally zip code or gender. But social login, on the other hand, here unlocks rich data, such as likes, interests, behaviors, or other relevant social graph information. Now, the first key when it comes to managing this data is thinking about how to store it and the mechanisms and databases that come along with that. So what we found is that to fully take advantage of social data, we suggest having a database solution that meets the following 3 criteria. First, it must be cloud-based. So a cloud-based database, as many of you may know, makes it possible to easily scale and upgrade with new features. The database must also be centralized. This is so that data from multiple web properties can be captured into one single location. We also recommend that the database have a dynamic schema. This allows for both unstructured and structured data to be stored with ease. I'll go into what I mean by that in my next slide. So we've seen is that the issue today with a lot of businesses when it comes to actually leveraging and managing this social identity data is that the majority of marketers still have relational databases. And in the past, you know, that was certainly fine, right? That's because a lot of the data at that time was more structured data that you're seeing there in the early part of 2000. But now, 90% of the data that's being generated is completely unstructured. So this goes back to my previous slide, talking about the fact that this data is composed of data points such as tweets, likes, shares, comments, reviews, video views, photos, texts, and more. So therefore, a database that is schemaless is critical to every marketer because it allows for the ability to store and take advantage of all of this unstructured data. Now, when it comes to the actual management of this data, it's really important for marketers to have the ability to access it and manage it in real time. So in the past, creating consumer data segments was an unnecessarily difficult task. For a lot of marketers, it really still is because it requires them to make IT requests each time they need to create a segment. So as many of you probably know, this process can take anywhere from hours to days depending on the IT queue that's already there. And it's really not an ideal process, right, for the agility and execution that's needed in today's hyper-connected world. So with dashboards like this one that we provide, marketers and others in the organization can simply log in from anywhere and create customer segments on the fly. They can also get a better understanding of consumer preferences and interests, and then apply these findings and push data to existing marketing software providers such as SailThrough. So moving on, I want to show you a few examples of ways that businesses can leverage this data set. So one example is sending a personalized email campaign. In this example you're seeing here, this user on Facebook has shown an interest in Andy Warhol. So when art.com is thinking about how they can get a better result from an email marketing campaign, the business could easily dynamically place relevant Andy Warhol artwork in their email, because this is showing works from artists that the user has clearly indicated they like on Facebook. Another advantage, of course, of social data is the fact that it's always up to date. So this example shows another email marketing campaign that can be triggered by updates a user makes to his or her social profile. So if you're looking at the left side of the screen, we're looking at the example that this user here, Claire, has updated her status to engaged. And as a result, this information is automatically updated in the database. So now, because the retailer has more access to this updated information, they can send Claire an email suggesting something like a wedding gown, and she's obviously in the market for this due to her recent engagement. So these two examples hopefully paint, you know, good suggestions for how you can leverage social data within marketing campaigns. Cassie will be giving you more examples later on, but first to tell you a bit about Gigya to give you an idea of where we are coming from in this space. At Gigya, we have a lot of experience helping marketers and enterprise businesses make sense of and leverage consumer identities. So to take a quick snapshot of our clients, we are working with over 750 enterprise brands, including 45% of the Comscore top 100 properties and 8 of the top 10 media websites in the world. Our technology is scaled internationally, reaching 1.5 billion consumers monthly. And not only are we a Facebook preferred marketing developer, but we're also a winner of the 2013 ZDNet CRM Watchlist Award and the CRM Rising Star winner. And our technology offers an end-to-end solution for consumer management. And as you're seeing here, this includes everything a business needs to connect with their consumers, collect and manage customer identity data, and convert these insights into actionable marketing. So with that in mind, I'll pass it over to Cassie now, who will go into more detail on best practices for personalized marketing.
Hi, everyone. Thanks again for joining us today. This is Cassie Young from SailThrough. As Kevin mentioned earlier, I'm SailThrough's Vice President of Optimization and Analytics, so I work with our client portfolio to make sure that they're leveraging our software to drive very effective retention marketing. So today, now that Amy's spoken a lot about consumer identity and management, we want to take things one step further and talk about how to leverage that type of information for effective customer retention. And the reality of today is that when you hear about a lot of the hot topics being thrown around in the marketing industry, a lot of them tie back to customer acquisition. So when you hear about attribution and channels. But from our seat, we actually believe that the number one metric that people should be focused on, or the number one theme, is retention, because customer retention has a really powerful halo effect on ultimately optimizing your customer acquisition and every other facet of the marketing ecosystem. So retention, again, most powerful lever for optimizing your marketing efforts. The reality from a recent study from eConsultancy is that it's oftentimes 5 times more cost-effective to retain existing customers than to acquire new ones, yet somehow only 16% of companies in North America right now are placing greater focus on retention than acquisition. So why does a shift need to happen? Why do they need to be focusing more closely on retention? Well, that answer comes in what we call the true cost of customer acquisition. So what do I mean with the true cost of customer acquisition? Well, first, let's think about the fundamental equation of defining successful marketing, and that comes down to customer unit economics. So specifically, we need to make sure that the amount of money we're going to extract out of every customer relationship is more than, and ideally substantially more than, how much it takes us to acquire a new customer. So let's walk through an example saying that we spent yesterday $1,000 on Google Ads. Out of that $1,000, we got 100 signups. The $1,000 divided by 100 nets out to a $10 cost per acquisition. The reality, though, is that this $10 cost per acquisition is the cost per acquisition of a name, not necessarily a customer. And what I mean by that is we have no idea downstream how many of those 100 signups are actually going to breed revenue for our company. So let's go back to our example of the unit economics and think of a brand where the customer lifetime value is $75. Looking at the cost of acquiring a name, $10, against that lifetime value of $75, we think that we're actually operating in the black on this. The reality, however, is the true cost of customer acquisition. So of those 100 signups, only 10 people go on to buy something, meaning that the cost to acquire a true customer is not the 1,000 divided by 100, but rather the 1,000 divided by 10, or $100 per customer. Going back to that example of the $75 customer lifetime value, suddenly you're actually looking at an ad buy that is substantially unprofitable that you're ultimately wanting to turn off. So what does this have to do with customer retention, you might ask? Well, optimizing customer retention has a two-pronged effect. The first is that it yields more profit per customer. How does it do that? Well, strong buyers are going to buy that much more frequently. They're going to spend more when they purchase, meaning that you extract greater lifetime value out of that customer. So that $75 number goes north. The other thing it does is that strong retention converts more non-buyers into buyers. So instead of only having 10 of those 100 people buy something, we may have 20 or 30. So there's this double effect of, one, improving the effective cost of true customer acquisition, and the second is, by improving lifetime value, giving acquisition marketers more cushion to work with when they're going out and figuring out how much they can actually spend to acquire a new customer. So how do we accomplish retention? Well, the way we accomplish retention is engagement. And yes, you're reading this correctly. I did not say conversions. I said engagement. And what I mean by that is engagement can very much breed conversions, but that equation does not always work the same backward. Just because someone converts and buys something does not mean that they're an engaged customer. That would be every retailer's wish, is that they never had to deal with a lapsed customer. The reality of engagement, though, is that it actually takes many different forms. And when I think about how we're actually identifying engagement, what we mean is some behavior that a user exhibits that has some kind of value, either today or maybe even tomorrow. So that engagement could be, you know, traditional metrics like purchases or site browsing, but it can also mean a lot of these sort of new activities that are born out of the social web and elsewhere, like video views, social sharing. This goes back to a lot of the things that Amy outlined around what people are doing in the social graph, leaving comments and reviews, so on and so forth. So really, you know, the key takeaway with engagement is that it's not necessarily about what happens today, but what value the behaviors you see today ultimately drive tomorrow. Think of it this way. You may not see any immediate conversion from people who watch product videos today, but it could turn out 6 months from now that people who are highly engaged with product videos spend more at each checkout and overall have a much stronger lifetime value of what they do. If you read a lot in the industry about how different companies define engagement, one of my favorite examples is a metric that Zynga has shared that they use, which is called their D1 engagement. D1 engagement is nothing to do with how many people download a game today. It's the number of people who've installed who come back day one or day after that app download. And that's a signal based on their historical data of how strong that person's engagement will be downstream. So again, it's not just about the present, it's also about the future. Now, the frustrating part in this is that all of those different forms of engagement that I mentioned are super important in addressing key business challenges. So Salesforce primarily works with companies in the retail and media spaces. I've highlighted a couple of their key challenges here, but there's proxies for these across pretty much any industry out there. And it goes back to things along the lines of what Amy mentioned around anonymous traffic. She gave some great tips for how to actually make that traffic prompt them to log in and make them identifiable. But it also comes back to things like, well, we're dealing with multi-channel, multi-device customers. How do we come up with this unified view of the user? We might have a low share of wallet, so how do we get insights into what our customers are doing with other brands? This is where some of the Facebook type of data becomes really, really powerful. How do we deal with the fact that a strong email still only has a 20% open rate and that lots of people unsubscribe? How do we keep managing retention in light of all of these challenges? Well, how do we actually achieve it? Retention sounds great. The silver bullet to accomplishing retention is one-to-one personalization. One-to-one personalization ensures that no two customers experience your brand in the same way. And the reality of this is that people have been talking about personalization for years, but there's a new face of personalization on the block, and it's so much more than just the name. When I talk about personalization from 5 years ago, it literally just meant putting Cassie, open this email for 20% off in the subject line. That's great, but it's not nearly as deep as we can go with the amount of data available to us today. So at SalesBrew, we like to think about the new face of personalization as being a three-tenant model called the bus model, and we hope after today you'll all get on board. What that bus model is one, behavioral. So what are your users doing in terms of time of day? When are they most likely to shop in the morning but convert in the evening? What about device? If you know that a user is most likely to convert off of the app instead of the mobile web, that's a prompt that maybe in the emails that you're sending out, you want to have deep links to the app so when the person clicks through, the app instantly loads on their device. The second bucket is usage, and this kind of dates back to the traditional segmentation approach to personalization, where brands think about attributes like recency and frequency and how that plays out on behavior. This is when you see those win-back messages like, Cassie, we haven't seen you in a while, here's a discount, come back and shop. That's great, and we're not trying to discount those practices, but the point is there's a lot of other attributes that we can layer on top of that traditional usage bucket well above and beyond. The third is situational. So this is the context of the user. So a great example of this is maybe a new customer signs up for your brand during the holiday season right after your Cyber Monday sale, and there's no inventory left. That no inventory left is a very, very weak customer experience that may ultimately have a negative impact on the downstream value of that customer or what their behavioral mechanics look like. So you want to keep in mind what is the user experiencing that may impact their perception of the brand in some way and act upon that in your future marketing. So beyond just the bus model, what else is true of one-to-one personalization? Well, it's about customer centricity. And what I mean about customer centricity is that it's not about product or content centricity. So what is the difference between those two topics? Product centricity or content centricity is pretty much most of the recommendation algorithms that you see on the internet. We know that I read an article about Andy Murray, and most people who read that article about Andy Murray are also reading about Wimbledon in general. So why don't I prompt them with other articles about Wimbledon? Customer centricity, on the other hand, looks at my historical user profile and what is true of me in terms of my interest profile. So maybe, yes, I did read this article on Andy Murray because there was something really interesting in the photo, but it turns out that most of my interests actually aren't about sports at all, but they're about the New York City technology scene. I would know that just because tons of other people who looked at this article read the other articles X, Y, and Z, I want to show Cassie the stuff that's has the strongest propensity to resonate with her interest profile and show her that information. So quick case study on this front. Business Insider is a client of ours that had for many years focused on content centricity, so the viewed also viewed model. A few years ago as they onboarded with SalesBrew, they tried out this customer-centric model. And basically the result of that is what you'll see is two of the same emails that go out on any particular day in terms of the template that's there. They're using SalesBrew to power the content that's inside. So what you'll see is user A gets a message where the top story has to do with more of a lifestyle story, where user B gets something that's more along the lines of technical hardware. Now, interestingly, that story about technical hardware, the Microsoft Surface, still appears in user A's email, but it's story number three versus story number one. This has had a massive impact for them in terms of overall engagement with not only email, but also post-click engagement in terms of depth of site session, et cetera, et cetera. So again, customer-centric personalization yields extremely strong returns. We're seeing across our client base 15% plus improvements in open rates. How does that happen, you might ask? Well, they're putting the content recommendations right in the subject line. We're seeing 60% plus improvement in click-through rates, which instantly means 60% plus more visitors to the website. And for the retail clients, we're often seeing gains in average order value or the average basket size at checkout by well above 8%. So we've talked a little bit about the bus model. We've talked about customer centricity. The final thing to talk about on this front is the fact that timing is everything. And to what Amy mentioned before about asking for data from the right user at the right time, thinking about getting a message in front of the user follows much of the same school of thought. We want to get the right message in front of the right customer in the right place and at the right time. So going back to the example I alluded to around the user who really engages through an app and giving them deep links, that's the type of user where maybe we want to be communicating with them with a push notification instead of a traditional campaign email. How do we tweak that according to the different types of clients, the different types of customers under management for the brand? You know, I mentioned email in passing before, and I think one of the challenges of marketing these days is that people are still hyper-focused on email. The reality of email is that a strong email has a 20% open rate, which begs the question, how do I get my message in front of the other 80% of my audience? And that's where other channels become really powerful. So whether it's on-site messaging, it's mobile, it's social. So some of Gigya's tools around gamification, et cetera, are interesting on this front. Even offline. So I'm seeing more and more online brands sending me postcards to my house these days. They're finding other ways to get in front of me. Really simple example of how powerful this can be. We have a sell-through client called Busted Tees that is an e-commerce player in the apparel space. They introduced a feature called personalized send time, which basically sends to users when they're most likely to convert. So if you think about how most brands send everyone an email at 7:30 in the morning, this feature says, well, I want to deploy the email between 7:30 a.m. and 5:30 p.m., and in that eight-hour window, I want to hit each user when they're most likely to make a transaction. By doing that, overnight, Busted Tees was able to drive an 8% lift in email revenue by the increase in purchase conversions that they were able to see. So there's big thinking here, but there's also opportunity for very small, seemingly incremental tweaks at the margin that can actually have a really big impact. So we've talked a lot about personalization, and especially the stuff about kind of the right time, the right place, it can get a little bit creepy. And in general, when we think about personalization, we think a lot at sell-through about how to respect the end user and how to think about the fine line between big data and big brother. And to do that, we use what we like to call the spandex rule. And the spandex rule basically says, just because you can do something doesn't mean that you should. So in general, before making a decision around because you looked at this navy shirt in a size medium, you should do X, Y, and Z, think about what the customer brand perception is going to look like, what you want to be known for. Really work to protect that brand equity by respecting the end user's preferences. The best way you can do this is to listen to the customer, really practice the doctrine of voice of the customer, and understand what constitutes effective marketing versus offending, your end customers. So you probably think to yourself, well, this all sounds way easier said than done. How do I possibly go about doing one-to-one personalization? The answer to that question is through 360-degree customer profile. So 360-degree customer profiles, or holistic customer profiles, are absolutely table stakes to one-to-one personalization. A lot of people talk about big data, and big data can be a really good thing, but it's not inherently a really good thing. And the reason why it's not inherently a really good thing is that because it actually has created a lot of data silos, which makes it very difficult to have this unified consumer management that Amy chatted a little bit about earlier. So, historically, understanding the customer profile might be, when did they join? When did they subscribe to emails? What did they buy? How recently did they buy? But now we have all these other different dimensions of the user. So it could be about when they opened an email or visited the site or what they bought, but it could also be about whether or not they're a Facebook fan. So we want to understand is there truly more intrinsic value in someone who is a social follower than someone who is not? It could also be something, more granular from the likes of someone like a Gigya, where it's that the user lives in LA, but they're actually a Yankees fan. So we can't do generic messaging around just the fact that they live in LA. It might be about the fact that they browse the site at 6 p.m., but they're opening emails around noon. They're more likely to be engaged at 6. All of these different facets coming under one roof. And that's exactly what we're in the business of doing here at Sailthrough. We are in the business of taking all of these different data silos and using them, so taking big data and using it to power what we call smart data. And that smart data ultimately manifests itself in three ways. It's through personalization, It's through automation. So there's certainly no way you can do one-to-one personalization in a non-automated way. It would be quite the undertaking. And the third is analytics, which I'm going to talk a little bit more about in just a second here. So just a second has expired. In terms of, you now have a unified view of the customer. Now what do you do with it? The answer to that is what we like to call multidimensional customer analytics. Sometimes I'll also call this situational analytics. But basically what we're seeing right now is that there is a massive convergence of marketing analytics and business intelligence. More specifically, you need to understand the downstream impact of every single marketing decision and optimization that you make. And so looking at this example, you know, historically maybe we just looked at the average order value of a customer. Now we want to understand, well, what's the average order value of someone who writes product reviews? So let's say with our sales through Gigya integration, we're passing in that data. That might be $80. Then we look at the average order value of people who watch product videos. That's $87. Well, now we look at the average order value of people who write reviews and watch product videos, and that's $97. So how do we drive people toward those really valuable behaviors? I'm seeing a lot of apps marketers recently issue app-specific discounts. So you only get 20% off if you redeem the code on the app. The reason for that is likely a function of multidimensional customer analytics. They see that people who buy on the app have a higher average order value and most likely purchase more frequently. So the goal is don't just get the customer analytics on a multidimensional basis, act on them. Drive users toward behaviors that are really valuable. This, if it's really valuable to write product reviews and watch product videos, prompt the user to do that in the right place and at the right time. The next thing is that once you have these analytics, you want to make sure that you're focusing on the metrics that matter. To explain what I mean by the metrics that matter, let me first start with the metrics that do not matter. So the metric that does not matter, this is a scary statistic from Forrester last year, and it's that 66% of marketers use open rates as the primary metric for email performance analysis. Our reaction at SailThrough to this statistic is something to the tune of what you're seeing on your screen. It's quite frankly just appalling. So when we talk about the metrics that matter, we're thinking about two specific buckets of metrics that are focused on more the downward part of the funnel. The first is quality and quantity. So the point of quality and quantity is that a lot of times your conversions can actually outweigh any top of funnel gains that you might see. So what I mean by that is, you know, a lot of times you may not see a lot of people redeeming a certain promotional code, but it turns out that the quality of people who redeem that promo code are really valuable downstream. And I'll give a specific example of this in a minute. Not surprisingly, the next topic is the downstream impact. So something may look really great today, but what happens 6 months from now? The best example of this is subscription free trials. So if you think about a lot of dating websites, they give out free trials to get people trying the service. The average monthly renewal rate of someone paying full price might be 80%. For someone who's using a free trial, it might be 40%. So we can't just go out and give out these free trials and give them away like free candy. We really need to think about what's happening. So going into some specific examples quickly, let's first look at quantity versus quality and talk about the Gmail promotional tabs. So I think most people on this line, as long as they haven't been living under a rock, know about the new promotional tabs that Gmail rolled out this summer. We wanted to examine the impact of this change at SailThrough. So we examined 70 million emails sent from our clients comparing Gmail conversion rates against the weighted average of the other top three, Yahoo, Hotmail, and AOL, immediately before the widespread rollout at the end of July and immediately thereafter. The result, not surprisingly, varied by client, was that open rates were down across the board. And honestly, the degree to which they were down was as significant as 94% in some places. However, while open rates are important, they're not the metric that matters here per my last slide. The metric that matters here is the value of any given open. So how do we define the value of an open? Well, the value of an open is for commerce, how much money we make off of that open, or for media, how many page views we generate off that open, which then, you know, ultimately breed ad impressions by way of proxy. What happened with the value of an open? Well, the value of an open went up, often to like the greatest increase we saw was as much as 705%. So on a per client basis, if open rates were down and value per open was up by a margin substantially less significant, well then maybe the decrease in volume was not enough to offset the improvement in quality. But the important thing to think about here is that oftentimes the improvement in quality will be more than enough to offset any deficit in quantity. So keep this in mind. One more quick example on quantity versus quality. I'm going to talk about responsive design. For those on the line who aren't familiar with responsive design is a practice that marketers are using to make sure that their messages, whether it's an email or on-site, render in the best way possible across all devices and browsers. So our client Business Insider, to give another example from their home front, they recently launched this whole responsive design initiative expecting to see a huge impact on the click-through rate of emails. Well, truth be told, depending on the different topic that we were looking at, click-through rate impact varied, but they saw a 51% lift in page use per open. So the value of any given open, regardless of what happened in that middle step of clicks, was so much more than needed to offset any, you know, variations you may have seen in click-through rate. The same thing happened with our client Colt Cosmetics, varying effect on click-through rate, but across the board, north of an 11% lift in cart conversion from rolling out that responsive design. Looking at downstream impact quickly, I'll give the example of welcome discounts. I constantly get in heated discussions with our retail clients about whether or not they should offer up a discount in their welcome email. The answer to that question is that you should test it. That's always the answer. It's the annoying consulting, it depends, but it depends on the test results. For today, I'm going to share the example of our client Savored, which is a division of Groupon, that tweaked their welcome series to move the initial activation discount out of day one and into either day 7, 14, or 30, depending on user behavior. The effect of that downstream was a 12% improvement in overall customer lifetime value, despite the fact that maybe they initially had fewer people buying on day one. So the takeaway from today is that there's a lot of data out there. I think Amy kind of really, you know, drove this home. Hopefully I've been doing the same. It's not just about big data, it's about smart data. And the reason why it's about smart data is because smart data really brings hope to marketers. What do we mean by that? We mean holistic profiling. So you have to have that 360-degree portrait of the user. It's not possible with just flat big data. O is the omni-channel strategies. You cannot possibly send someone an email message saying that you missed them if they were in the app yesterday because you don't have that cross-level data. Same thing goes with offline versus online behaviors. The P is personalized experiences. Again, the number one way to achieve effective customer retention is personalization on a one-to-one level. And E is efficacy in the numbers. All of this stuff is meaningless unless you can really prove it. So again, always be testing, always be measuring. Think about those situational, multidimensional analytics. So SailThrough, just to kind of give you a quick overview of what we do, we're focused on this customer retention piece of what happens, and we're focused on it on a one-to-one personalized cross-device, cross-platform approach to what we do. The result of that has been that across our client base, we're seeing, on average, a 178% higher propensity for customers to engage with a brand after 90 days. So it's easy to drive engagement in day 15 or 30, but what we're really focused on is the long tail and how we keep customers around for the long haul. We work with about 400 clients across the commerce and media verticals, and you know, we really hope that you'll consider joining some of those leading marketers in driving unparalleled levels of customer retention. With that, I think Amy and I both thank you for your time, and we'd love to open it up to some audience questions.
Thanks so much, Kathy. That was some really valuable stuff there. So yeah, it's time to open up for questions, so please use the chat window and the GoToWebinar control panel, and we'll try to answer as many questions as possible. I think we'll give Kathy a little break right now and have Amy answer the first question, which is, how are you addressing customer concerns over data privacy?
Yeah, it's a good question. It goes back to a lot of what I talked about, the value of social login, especially when it comes to being transparent with your end users and making the data that you collect permission-based. I really think that's going to continue to be important, as I mentioned, as we see both government regulations as well as just consumers becoming more data savvy and aware of what's being captured. From a Gigya perspective in particular, there's a couple things that we've done to really get ahead of the consumer privacy trend. One of which is that we've hired a chief privacy officer in the past year. So Jill on our team advises us on changing policies and how we can best protect our clients as well as consumer data. Something else we recently came out with that I'd be happy to follow up with you all on after this is a service that we offer known as our Social Privacy Seal. So this is a partnership with the Future of Privacy Forum, a leading advocate for privacy in the United States. And it's a consumer-facing seal that can actually be displayed in close proximity to social login. So So it really makes the user be aware, similar to a VeriSign or a trustee, that the business is using their data in compliance with a couple of core tenets that we outline within that seal.
Cool. Thanks, Amy. And then, Kathy, I have one for you here, which is, you know, how do you measure engagement for clients? If you could provide some more insight into that.
Sure. I think the big thing comes back to what we mentioned about thinking about not just what qualifies as valuable today, but what qualifies as valuable behaviors even 6 months or a year from now. So engagement really is any behavior that a customer or user might demonstrate that ultimately breeds more revenue to your business. But again, it doesn't need to be a conversion today. It can be something that happens downstream. Now, you might say to yourself, well, what about a media business? They don't actually, you know, take dollars directly from the end user. Well, there's an interesting proxy there where if you get people to engage in a media property by writing reviews, maybe they ultimately end up viewing more pages, which ultimately yields more ad impressions that the ad sales team can go and sell that does bubble back up to the top line. So I think in general, it's, you know, the number one thing to look out for is there's no silver bullet for an engagement metric. You have to figure out the metric that matters for your business, but be sure to have the long tail view of measuring the impact of what that's going to have.
Great. Thanks, Kathy. And I have another one here for Amy, which is regarding the slide on best practices for social login. What are good times to ask a user to register?
Sure. Yeah, this probably goes a bit off of what Kathy was saying, how there might not be a specific silver bullet. I really wouldn't say that there's a right or wrong time specifically. It's more about thinking about the value proposition and making sure you're creating that two-way street. So I'd encourage you as a brand or you as a business to ask yourself, when am I creating value for the end customer, right? Is it through a loyalty program I want them to join where they're going to get rewards? Am I going to be showing gated content in return for them registering? Some brands do this right up front. An example of a client we work with that does that is Rue La La, because as you might know, with Rue La La, they've created that shopping experience that's gated and that's really prestigious to join. So that's their value, and that's why they can ask a user right in the very beginning to register with their social profile.
Cool. And I have a question that can be fielded by anyone here, which is, do these concepts apply to B2B as well as B2C?
Sure,
Amy, go ahead. Yeah,
I think they do. B2B is certainly it's a different world when you're thinking about how to apply registrations, right? And again, it's why is the user logging in, and what do I want to know about these users? We've seen some really good use cases for social login in the B2B space, particularly as it applies to two things. One is loyalty, and the other is in lead generation, right? So if you think about any contact me form on any B2B site, it's easy to augment that with a LinkedIn profile, for example, right, to understand not just the name and email that you might be capturing otherwise, but company name, past work experience, and so forth. You're really getting access to that full user history. The other example I mentioned is loyalty or gamification. So loyalty gamification in the B2B space is pretty big. If you think about, you know, someone like Microsoft, right, who has this B2B community that's really generated by other businesses coming in and answering questions and answering support questions about products and features, that saves Microsoft a ton of money not having to field that themselves. So they do that by creating a socially immersive rewards experience for those users who participate, rewarding them with badges or with points and with status for doing so.
Cool. Kathy, anything else?
Yeah. For sure. So completely agree with Emily, everything that Amy mentioned. The one other thing I would add comes back to how to measure engagement as well as the one-to-one personalization piece. So the reality of B2B marketing, as Amy just alluded to, is that it's really, really heavy on the content marketing side. So when you think about defining engagement, it's not just about downloads of white papers or whatever it might be. It also needs to be more specific on precisely which types of messaging are resonating with users at different times of day. So maybe they're likely to read something highly technical during the workday, but in the evening they want a lighter read on industry trends. It's really just making sure that your engagement goes, I mean, across the board, even on B2C, you want to take those metrics as deep as you can take them. But I think where content marketing is concerned, it's honestly mission critical to doing an effective job.
Great, thanks. So this next question is addressed for Kathy. So it's can you show an example of how someone makes social data actionable?
Sure. So I'll actually give an example that pertains to both Sail Through and Gigya. So I mentioned all this talk of one-to-one personalization, and we're able to do that by building interest profiles on users. So we know based on what you look at, what you buy, what types of interest you have, user A is more likely to buy apparel, user B is more likely to buy accessories. The challenge, though, is what Amy mentioned around the fact that, you know, for any company, 90%+ of traffic could be anonymous, or, you know, we just don't have rich data on them. By having the social data and augmenting that 360-degree portrait of the user with social data, we're getting information about interests that would not otherwise be available to us because maybe that customer is not yet that engaged with our brand. And what that lets us do is it lets us say, okay, well, I know from their Facebook data that this user is interested in themes A, B, and C. They haven't done anything on my website. But I know that other customers who have those same interests in A, B, and C buy these items. So let me go and market these specific items through lookalike modeling back to those customers where I don't necessarily have brand specific information on them. So honestly, like there's so many different ways to make that actionable, but I think some of the Facebook profile data to me is particularly compelling. And what's super exciting to me is something I alluded to earlier around actually being able to understand what is the value of someone who likes your brand versus other brands on Facebook versus someone who doesn't have that information or whatever other attribute you may want to look at that time.
Great. So, Amy, this question's for you, and it's, should I get rid of my existing registration system and just use social login?
Good question. Interesting question. Might be counterintuitive for some of you, but we actually don't recommend that overall. We're finding that social login and social registrations are becoming very advantageous and are growing, but right now they're accounting for about 40% of all registrations. So again, it's growing, and we've seen over half the internet, as I mentioned, actually log in socially. But some of our customers do only offer social login as a result of that. But those use cases are more specific to the brand or specific to mobile, for instance. So if we're thinking about a standard website, we do encourage you to use both social login paired with standard registration as well.
Okay. I think I have one question here, which is a good last question to close on, and it could be answered by both Amy and Kathy. I think you guys should both answer it, which is, what can I do today to get started with leveraging social data? Kathy, why don't you go first?
Sure. So in terms of what you can do to get started today, you have to start capturing the data and building a unified view of the customer. So one of the things that will make marketers really frustrated is they're ready to deploy all of these awesome campaigns and get really creative around their behavioral targeting, but they don't have the data infrastructure in place in terms of having the historical data to act on. So if there is one thing you can do today, it's putting forth a strategy for how to build that unified view of the customer and collecting those different data sources so that, you know, 6 months from now when you're maybe finally, you know, ready to push the up to pump the gas on actually doing some neat stuff around one-to-one or behavioral, you have an arsenal of historical data to empower you to do so.
Right. Yeah, I really want to echo what Kathy said. The first step is really just accessing the data. So it's really something that we're working with a lot of our clients on now. Everyone always talks about the end part of the conversion funnel, right? What type of messages can I send? How can I utilize this data? But I think the truth is just first getting the data, pouring through it, understanding it, pulling out customer insights. That's really what's going to help you understand better the type of strategy you want to implement as a result of this data. So first step, again, implementing a strategy for accessing that data.
Great. So I think we can end on that. And thanks, everyone, for attending. And we will definitely follow up in the next day or so with a recorded version of the webinar so you can share with colleagues and with people that missed it. All right. Thanks. Have a good one.